Today we're going to be discussing the work of Thomas Malthus, who lived from the late 18th century through the early 19th century. You'll notice that he was born about 10 years before Adam Smith wrote or published The Wealth of Nations, so you can see that he was slightly after Smith. Now, one of the things we have to remember with Malthus is that his view about social change is much different from that went with the mid-18th century vision. Smith, remember, had a very optimistic vision that society would eventually evolve into a much better world for everyone through the increasing productivity associated with the advances of the capitalist economies. But after Smith, we have the French Revolution, we have the Industrial Revolution, and we find a much more difficult life emerging for the average worker in England. And so, in a sense, this optimistic vision was contradicted by the actual experience of people, and therefore it gave rise to some new ideas in philosophy that had an impact on many of the thinkers of the time. What had happened prior to this was, among the Enlightenment writers, was this classical liberal idea that individualistic rights and responsibilities would be the path to a happy future. However, given what had happened to the average worker in this new capitalist society that was becoming consolidated by the 19th century, you began to have an alternative point of view and an alternative philosophy, and that socialist ideas emerged as an alternative both to the old social structures like that of feudalism and the new ones. They wanted to end the remnants of the feudal order, and they also noticed that the deadly impacts of the new liberal order of capitalism should be defeated. Two of the writers in this period who were on the kind of what you might call the left were the Marquis de Condorcet in France. He was a moderate liberal and active in the French Revolution in the early part of it. He advocated for greater economic equality and more security, and felt that this kind of progress would be great for the future of humanity, and that the French Revolution, he thought, set the stage for this higher level of society. Now, de Condorcet's specific reforms are actually rather minor if we look back on them from a modern eye. He wanted to establish a welfare fund for widows and orphans, which is pretty straightforward as something that is needed for people who are without means. The second one, though, is quite interesting. He wanted to restrict the extension of credit because he wanted to reduce the economic power of the capitalists that he saw emerging as a source of anti-egalitarianism. Now, de Condorcet's reforms never went anywhere, but they did provoke a response from Malthus, which we'll get to in a moment. William Godwin, another person affected by the increasing challenges facing the working people of England, he had a much more radical view. He felt that any of the defects that you might see in the working class, irresponsibility, any kind of problem, was a result not of the people in any sort of fundamental sense, but it was a result of corrupt and unjust institutions. And of all of these, private property was the worst of such institutions. Now, he didn't mean private property like, you know, your own toothbrush or your own house or anything like that, but he felt that private property and the means of production, the factories and so on, led to these problems that the working class faced. He felt that any of the negative behaviors of workers would go away if people could just get the basic necessities of life. And so he argued that it was the battle for subsistence that often led to undesirable behavior by working class people. And he argued, on the contrary, that private property would mean that many would be deprived of the basic necessities. Only a handful would prosper greatly. He argued that government was controlled by those with property, and so therefore the government could not be a mechanism for the massive reform required to abolish private property. Now, Godwin sounds like he's about ready to talk about a revolution to overthrow the whole system of capitalism, but he was not like that. He felt that human reason would lead people to come together and see the error of their ways. They would begin to understand that if property were abolished, or at least distributed to those who needed it, that lives of everyone would be better. Now, it's a little bit idealistic, I would say, but in any event, his books were widely read throughout England, even among the aristocracy. They even became a favorite, you might call it a coffee table book, in the late 18th and early 19th century drawing rooms. I've often thought that Godwin reminds you a lot of the 19th century abolitionists, people like William Lloyd Garrison, who argued that moral suasion was needed to end slavery. And in fact, he tried to send his newspaper down to southern slaveholders to try to convince them that they would be better off if they were no longer slaveholders. Well, they responded to that by getting Congress to pass a law making it illegal to send abolitionist literature to the South. He felt that the slaveholders would in fact give up slaves and privileges once they learned the proper moral lessons. Well, it didn't work, although it did create a very broad movement, and within that movement, John Brown emerged with the 1859 Harper's Ferry Raid, which really began the process of civil war in the United States, although it wasn't officially declared until 1861, and demonstrated that violence was needed to end slavery. And so in the same way that Godwin and early utopian socialists and anarchists like Godwin felt that they eventually produced a Karl Marx. And Marx, of course, argued for a violent proletarian revolution that would end private property in the means of production. So that's the context. We have these liberal reformers moving away from the historic classical liberal tradition. And then we have Thomas Malthus, a conservative clergyman, coming into this debate. He differed from the Enlightenment figures, who emphasized human reason instead of heavenly influences, and he had a very pessimistic view about the human condition. Now, he did say that people like the Marquis de Condorcet and William Godwin were well-intentioned, but he said their schemes, he argued, were fated to fail. And so he comes up with this notion that the law of population will be the factor that prevents a better world from coming forward. Now, the law of population is pretty straightforward. Populations potentially grow at a geometric rate, he says, if you have unlimited food. Richard Cantillon, from the Essai sur la nature du commerce en général, had said a similar thing. Men multiply like mice in a barn when they have unlimited means to maintain their life. The food supply, he says, on the other hand, this is Malthus again, grows only at an arithmetic rate, relatively slow expansion of cultivation and relatively slow improvement of agricultural technology. So the food supply is not going to keep up with population if that is a tendency for the population to grow without limit. Malthus also argued that people are driven by an insatiable drive for sex, which leads to more population. And this is interestingly in contrast to Godwin, who argued that the sex drive would weaken as society becomes more advanced intellectually and less animalistic. Well, from this point of view, Malthus, unlike Godwin, argued that population will always grow faster than the food supply. This could lead to massive starvation, which would bring population growth to a halt. And the always limited food supply is what he considered a natural check to population growth, a positive check. Now, he doesn't think starvation is a very good idea. He's okay with not having starvation, but he says if we could have some preventive checks, that would be better. He called for later marriages, but he also called for earlier mortality through disease. So if there's a nice section in your textbook about one of his writings about making streets narrower and more disease-ridden and so on, I'd encourage you to take a look at that. Preventive checks, he thinks, to the extent that they work at all, would have to come from a very structured and hierarchical society that would enforce its will, and it would provide a visible example of a better life. And he argued that with Godwin and any other egalitarian system, there was only equal poverty and no incentive to abstain from sex or adding to the population. Well, Malthus also had a number of other economic ideas beyond his law of population, although that's what he's most known for. He felt that, like many other classical economists, that wages would be driven to a subsistence level and perhaps even below by the law of population combined with competition in the labor market. The classical economists, including David Ricardo, who we'll cover soon, generally agreed. Profits, he thought, were payments to capitalists for increasing productivity in agriculture. Rents are the result of the differential fertility of the soil, and there'll be more on this under Ricardo, who has a somewhat similar view. But here's where he differs from Ricardo and certainly from earlier writers. He thinks that rents that landlords receive are not unearned, even though they don't do anything to produce anything except own the land. He felt that rents would be an appropriate distribution of revenues simply because property ownership of land was proper. And therefore, he goes even further, arguing that you might want to maintain the landed aristocracy with high rents, which would allow that class to serve as an example to everyone else about how to aspire to live. The other area of great interest with Malthus is his theories on gluts and depression. And here there's a very modern, almost Keynesian aspect to his thinking. He argues that capitalism tends necessarily towards gluts. That's a relative overproduction of goods and services relative to the demand for them, and also depressions that result from that. And he's very concerned about the destabilizing impact of gluts, depressions, and crises. The Peterloo Massacre, which was a named for a kind of a mocking the Waterloo of Napoleon, the Peterloo Massacre was the killing of a lot of workers in Manchester during a major glut, which led to massive unemployment and therefore a rebellion by the working class of Manchester. And so he thought, this was terrible, we have to do something to prevent gluts from overcoming the natural order of society. Now, Smith and many other classical writers felt that there was a circular flow that would lead to a tendency towards full employment and harmony, and we'll be talking more about this later, but Say's law is the notion that supply creates its own demand. The very act of bringing together land, labor, and capital and producing goods means that the value of the goods that are produced is exactly equal to the value allocated to the owners of the means of production, the factors of production in general, wages. So wages, rents, and profits would equal the value of the bundle of goods that come out at the end of the production process. And if that were true, then there would never be a glut. But Malthus disagreed. He felt that effectual demand, what we would call aggregate demand today, could fall short of production. He argued that workers consume all of their income, so there's no problem with their consumption. And landlords also are very good at consuming and even hiring service workers who also consume all of their income. But the problem is the capitalists. The capitalists are trying to constantly reinvest to expand production rather than consume the surplus product that they are taking from the worker. If the capitalists reinvest their current technology, then they will run out of unemployed workers to hire because the population growth is a lagged process, unlike investment spending. Some capital would therefore not be used. It couldn't find workers, and capitalists would then hoard the money and not spend. And so, as wages rose, more capital would be idled. Capitalists would lose profits, and then this would create a glut of goods on the market. Now, if they reinvest with new technology, it leads to the same thing. They'll produce more goods with fewer workers. Finding a market for the swelling volume of goods may be difficult, and then this leads to less employment than is needed to avoid the labor distress that Malthus associated with the Peterloo Massacre. The problem for Malthus is that there is too much profit going to the capitalists because they are not using their profit to consume goods and services, but rather to reinvest. So therefore, we have to take away these profits and give them to a class that can spend effectively to maintain employment. The two classes are the landlords or workers. So which one did Malthus think was the appropriate one? Well, of course, the landlords. Now, as I said at the beginning, there is a modern Keynesian ring to Malthus's view because, after all, Keynes argues that there is a long-term tendency towards depression and unemployment, involuntary unemployment. And he, even in his appendix to The General Theory, his famous work from 1936, gives a tribute to Malthus for having some very good insights on this matter. Thank you very much.